Hey there, folks. Glenn with the Cactus Atlas, about to explore deep in Agua Fria National Monument north of Phoenix in search of old Native American ruins.
Alrighty, my friends, it's you got me and Slim today, although Slim's gonna keep quiet on this one too, I think, and we're heading into Agua Fria National Monument on the Bloody Basin Road, which we've done before. If you've watched our channel, we've driven this entire length of this road to something called the Sheep Bridge that borders the Mazatzal Wilderness. Many, many miles, a full day journey down some very bumpy roads back here. Today we're not going quite that far, and I'll explain what we're up to as we make our way to our location. We got a little ways to go. All right, so basically what are we doing then? Well, we've been here once before and we did a little sampler of some of the types of ruins you can find back here. And we actually went up to a place called Pueblo La Plata, I think, or La Plato. Can't remember 100%, it'll be on the screen, but there was a little Fort Silver, I think it was, on this little finger of land that went out, and we explored a little bit about these people called the Perry Mesa culture. The way I interpret it is a little bit of like an offshoot culture off the Hohokam that we study a lot on this channel, that moved up higher to higher elevation up to these grasslands and mesas above Phoenix. And we didn't really go into a lot of detail, I don't think, so this episode is going to be kind of a scavenger hunt as we use some publications I found to locate some of these things, and petroglyphs and all sorts of stuff. So, and I'm going to teach you a little bit more about who we think these people were along the way on this episode today. And all in all, I mean, there's a lot of ground to cover, a lot of miles to drive, some slow going driving, so there's no way we are going to be able to locate everything we're looking for today. But I tell you what I'll do. Let's give you a quick summary here of the trail, what we're doing, and I'll catch up with you here in a little bit.
This is the part when I'm supposed to tell you about the plan, which is that I was going to seek out 2 of 7 major sets of ruins here in Agua Fria. I was going to narrate some knowledge and then show you some examples on location in a very controlled, organized, and educational way. Well, I underestimated how much time I would spend wayfinding on foot when barriers not shown on maps now prohibit the way at times, or how roads just disappear into endless seas of grasslands, making sticking to roads impossible, and just how green and blended in things look here in the spring. If there are foot trails here, I usually couldn't spot them. In retrospect, when the grass is green, it's probably not the best time to seek out the ruins here in Agua Fria. Although it's possible you'll have the same issue when the grass turns yellow. It'll just be a different color to confuse you. There are few signs that people come out to these places anymore, hence why no established paths. Only signs of life I saw were the hoof prints of cattle. But we were successful in most of the plan, and we do have discoveries to share. But we did have to skip one section due to some very sudden and ugly weather, which is when the episode changes to Escape from the Agua Fria. But sometimes these unplanned, underestimated adventures are the best ones, and I had fun at least. So today, the theme of the show is do not underestimate the Agua Fria. If you want to find some of these places yourself, you're going to have to work for it in very rugged places where some very dangerous critters live. This isn't to deter you, but to show you it can get real at times. This ain't Montezuma Castle back here.
And here is the mighty Agua Fria River. Not so mighty looking, is it? I would say this is the lowest flow I've encountered down here. And it hasn't been much worse than this. What I can tell you in the past is this, you know, kind of little raised area they built here is a little bit more obscured, and you might think, oh, it's deeper than it is. But I mean, I've never seen this be a problem. I'm sure it can be, and certainly for the wrong vehicle, but not exciting at all. In fact, today it's shallow enough I could actually walk through in my boots and not even get my feet wet, my waterproof boots.
All right, Slim's tires are getting wet. It's that wet nap that he likes to give his tires a nice little spritz and rinse. Okay, so my first location today is probably the most enigmatic of them all, meaning when I was studying aerial photos, like satellite photography, trying to locate some of these ruins we're going to be looking for, out of all of the satellite photos and studies I did, this first location is one where I'm the most unsure, and I really had trouble spotting them. I think I may have located them, and I think I may see why, but I'm really not going to know until we get on the ground. And there's some other interesting things that I believe I may have located that I don't think I'm going to be able to get to on foot. But luckily, that's why we have our drone to help us survey some of this stuff today. And as I explained in my little briefing, you know, I've got little GPS waypoints all over the place. I lost count of how many. Part of my scavenger hunt for where I think the ruins were located. And then as I confirm them on my personal maps, I got a little color scheme where the blue ones were undiscovered, and then I'll switch them to green once I'm sure what I was looking at is a ruin. Because keep in mind, I'm using satellite imagery, and sometimes the quality is questionable depending on what program you're using. So it's kind of a fun puzzle to solve. I really enjoy doing this. So if you don't really care about the people and the history and you just like the scavenger hunt aspect of what we're going to be doing, I think you'll enjoy this today too, because I think there's some discovery aspects to this. And I'm keeping it kind of cash here for myself too. So I think our turn, the one that I marked off, should be right here. You could see how quickly you could miss one of these turns, especially since the grasses are so lush and green now. And here's where I don't know the trail report. I already see lots of off-camber, rutted, fun stuff here. No problem for us, but you know, for you, this is where it might all start to break down.
You can see the place we turned off of Bloody Basin Road. For the short time we were on it, the road wasn't bad. A couple rutted spots, but shortly after we passed Bull Tank, we encountered a gate where motor vehicle traffic is prohibited beyond that point. In my planning, Onyx showed the road going all the way to my first waypoint. This is going to add some unplanned time to my game plan. If you look towards the horizon and see those electric towers, our first waypoint appears to be at the left of the two. Coincidentally, it's also where I thought the road would take me, hence why I chose that as my base of operations. So off on foot I went.
So this is a good lesson to learn, though, that you may not always get to where you think you're going to be able to get, and if you're planning time and stuff like that, you got to add extra time for this kind of thing. So
for a while, there was a clear trail where others had walked before, but that began to change, and before I knew it, I lost the trail. Almost all the time, I could see where I wanted to go, but no clear way. My apprehension was, I read that Agua Fria hosts venomous reptiles like the western diamondback and Mojave rattlesnake, the worst kind you can get bit by. I don't know if this is the type of terrain they like out in the volcanic rock atop the mesa, but I was on high alert and trying to make noise. One reason I like to film and talk aloud when I'm wandering around.
Alrighty, my first waypoint to confirm or deny is like right up here. If there is something here, hopefully I can get up on these rocks and we can see better.
I struggled to see anything definitive from the ground, and with the help of the drone, I was hoping to pick something out. I believe I saw what looked like a couple square structures, the one I saw in the satellite photos, but not nearly as well formed as what I'm looking for. This was proving to be a dud as I feared. The more interesting stuff I pinned was almost a half mile from my current position, obscured by a hill. I was hoping to use my drone to check it out, but I'd not be able to maintain a line of sight to the drone, and the wind started kicking up at the edge of the canyon, so I had decided to abort to avoid problems.
So best as I could tell, flying my drone around here where I see these smaller piles of rubble, there seem to be some square-shaped rooms that I can't make out from down here. But as far as I can tell, this is the site of Baby Canyon Ruin, or one of them. There's some on the other side also. Gonna have to really do a review of my footage when I get home, my aerial footage, because I was flying it under the power lines, being very careful. And I don't like doing that, so I didn't spend a lot of time doing it. But I was having a really hard time in the direct sun seeing my display so I could pick out the detail I needed to. And I think I may have seen some things that my mind thought was geometry, like a rectangle.
but I won't know until I get home. It does kind of correspond with what I saw on satellite views. And like I said, there's not much to it. And I think there's good stuff out beyond, kind of on the canyon shelf maybe, that wasn't even on maps, that I wanted to fly my drone over to, but I opted not to. So now my words of caution, I guess, if you're gonna do this. I could have easily spent more time there, and I'm confident I would have found everything I was looking for, petroglyphs, especially with the info I have on me. But it's pretty treacherous over there. I mean, like, you see these grasslands, the grasses are tall, but it is a minefield of volcanic rocks, large ones like the ones you see on the side of the road, as well as smaller ones that are loose and they roll under your feet. So you're walking on this grass that's hard to see, and then you got all of these rolling rocks under you, all of these crevices. Sometimes you're leapfrogging from volcanic rock to volcanic rock. So that's a hazard. Breaking an ankle, something like that, really easy to do. The other hazard is, just like I read in the publication, the soils up here are actually not that bad, and they can run pretty deep, and there's lots of dirt, and you could see where it was once muddy. People were riding their horses back here, so you see footprints, you see like the hoof prints from animals that sunk into the mud, and then when it dries, it becomes a hole. So, you know, there are lots of little holes all over the place back here, made by those mud holes, the rocks. So you got to go really slow. And then not to mention rattlesnake concerns too. This comes across as a place that rattlesnakes would probably like, all the rocks and stuff like that. And the very limited visibility walking through there did not make me feel comfortable. So you add all that together, plus the amount of time I have scheduled to do all of this stuff. And for me, it just didn't work out.
Our next stop, where I was very confident that we'd find what we're looking for, will take us a little further down the Bloody Basin Road to Forest Road 14. If you check out the PDF we linked to below, you'll see that FR 14 is where a large collection of ruins remain, much more than we could possibly see in a day. For today, I wanted to explore an example of one of the larger sets of ruins, named the Perry Tank Group, consisting of about 300 rooms. As with many of these, the guide indicates that there is stuff to see on both sides of the canyon, like the Rattlesnake House on the southern side, so my plan was to drive up to the north side first and check out the north side ruins labeled Pueblo Pato, and then drive around to the south side to complete a set and conclude the video. Unlike the road to Baby Canyon, the road out to the next set was not blocked, but instead the grasses up here grow so green and lush that eventually I lose the road again and have to head out on foot. Along the way, there are some gates you'll need to open, but these are to keep the cattle in. But do note, this road is very rough, but in small spurts, mainly around washes. Don't bring your Honda Civic back here. I had to laugh because although I have driven many dirt roads at this point, never have I driven a grass road, a new class of challenge. Eventually, I found driving any further would take longer than just hoofing it, and at that point, I was close to becoming a level 2 armchair archaeologist, so I opted to navigate the terrain on foot. As I approached the site, I began to see the telltale signs of these structures from ground level.
I'm almost positive that's one. You see that rise right there? That pile of rocks? I think that's exactly what we've come looking for.
And yep, those GPS points on my map are green, meaning a confirmed visual confirmation from the ground. Ladies and gentlemen, we made it. Let's explore Pueblo Pato and some of its outliers.
Yeah! We found it. Let's take a look at this. Man, this is a adventure here. It's not dissimilar from my remembrance of Pueblo La Plata, the touristy one I keep mentioning, even though I wouldn't say it's touristy. It was very similar to this when you're walking up on it. And when you peek over, you'll start to see the actual rooms and the geometry. You see that? Perry Mesa culture, I have come here to honor your memory.
Here's a nice overview of the area we're exploring. Can you spot the ruins? It can be hard sometimes when the light is not ideal. It's probably about time I give you a little info about what this is. The 14th century ruins you see before you are the leftover walls of Pueblo-like complexes made by a pre-Columbian culture archaeologists named the Perry Mesa Tradition, an offshoot of the more well-known Hohokam. I've not seen any artist renditions of these structures, but the way I understand it, these were not true pueblos, but rather one-story structures consisting of a small number of thick outer walls, often feet thick, with the only entry being from the top using ladders. Within would have been an interconnected hive of rooms, a mix of storage and residential. To live up here, the people exploited the soil for its moisture-retaining properties and successfully farmed. The deep canyons provided ample opportunities for hunting and riparian habitats. The structures are interesting in that they serve as very defensible fortresses, since the old cultures of the Southwest did not have siege technology. It's thought that this period of the 14th century experienced conflict between neighboring cultures, and forts and lookouts can be found all over the area. We may never know the precise reasons why these people built these pueblo-like castles at the edge of canyons, but it's mysteries like this that keep me motivated.
And then you have to kind of wonder too. I mean, I was reading that publication that we're going to share with you in the description. You know, a lot of these were not excavated by professional archaeologists. This was more the handiwork of vandals and people stealing pottery. So who knows what untold discoveries are under the earth still? I'm sure there are some, but will they ever be uncovered? I don't know. Here's some big pot sherds, some of the biggest I've ever seen. You see that? And yeah, do I want to pick it up and touch it? I so do. And you're like, well, somebody already did, but I want to set a good example for you. Like, here's my hand for scale. I mean, those are pretty good sized sherds there. All right, we're kind of driving right into the storm, whatever that is. And man, I think I see rain bands. It just looks like it could be, I'm pretty sure I see rain not far from here. God dang it. I want to get you some footage of this storm that just snuck up. I mean, I am just about to be under the clouds. It is moving fast. I see some rain coming down. Okay, so the episode has now turned into, can we get out of here before I get poured on and hopefully avoid any kind of flooding problems down at the Agua Fria River? With them getting that much rain up north there, that could be an interesting thing. That crossing might be a completely different story by the time we get back around to it.
From there, I decided to call off all other plans for the day, including the plan I had for this episode to explore the other side of the canyon. Can't fly a drone in these conditions anyway, which I believe is essential to better study these places. At times, the sky looked worrisome, and all this transpired in a very short amount of time. It wasn't that long ago that I was drenched in sunshine exploring the canyon edge. You could see some areas out towards the Bradshaws getting dumped on. Slim even got a nice little shower before it was all said and done. When we got back to the Agua Fria River, I quickly saw there was no danger and the stream was as it was before. And from there, I knew we'd be okay. Just a few more miles back to Interstate 17 and then home to Phoenix.
All right, folks, there you have it. A journey into the Agua Fria never disappoints. Now you see how challenging it is to go find stuff out there. At least we got some of the country mapped out for you on video, and we know the current state in 2024, and we will not underestimate it next time we head out this way. Thanks for joining me, and I gotta get in the truck. It's freezing. We're gonna come back, Perry Mesa culture. We'll be back. Bye.